live from the wonderful Commodore Ballroom in the heart of Vancouver, British Columbia. How are you guys doing today? Yeah? All right. What I want to do to start off is to get a gauge of the energy level of this room, and I think it's going to be pretty jam-packed with energy here. But let's see. I'm going to list out some things that you'll be seeing here today, and you respond accordingly with your applause, all right? So on this very stage tonight, you will be seeing world-class industry speakers. How do you guys feel about that? Yeah? All right. You will also be engaging in roundtable discussions, cloud expo, and networking opportunities galore. How do you guys feel about that? Yeah? Alrighty. And I think this third one is probably the one that's going to get the best response. At this event today, we will be having an open bar. Yeah? Oh, there you go. Even the light system enjoyed that one.
Thank you.
So I'll tell you right now, I am actually not an employee of Traction On Demand. So I am in no fear of losing my job. They asked me if I wanted to host the event, and I was like, of course I do. I actually come from the field of marketing. My father is a doctor, obviously. there's a little humor for you there. But the one thing that me and my dad have in common is that we both deal with, at the core of it, people. Now, my dad is a surgeon. He cuts into people, right? And me, as a marketer, I cut into people's wallets. It's a little bit of a marketing humor. We should probably open the bar right now. So a lot of you actually work for Traction On Demand, and a lot of you work with Traction On Demand. I'm not sure if all of you are aware, though, of the history of the company, and we're going to take a look at one of the first incarnations of the Traction office, and that's right over here. Now, not a lot of people know this, but this is where it all started off. There were two people, along with CEO and founder, Greg Malpass. So this is where Greg Malpass worked tirelessly, endless nights doing research, all the work that he needed to do to start the company. He also churned his own butter. Did you know that? He churned his own butter in this very building. It didn't taste all that good, but that's probably for the best. Otherwise, we would all be here right now celebrating butter. Now, of course, stagnation was impossible for the company, and this slide here represents the company on the move. What we see here is a Caucasian gentleman being helped by an Asian man. So this slide pretty much represents the entire technology industry right there. It's, yeah. You're just missing the East Indian guy, right? You stick him in there and you've got it covered. Now, Traction On Demand, I have had the extreme pleasure of visiting the office out in Burnaby, and I can tell you right now, it is insane. How many of you folks, some of you work there, right? But if you go there, there is a door that looks like somebody burst through it just to get out, and that is because it is a door that somebody burst through just to get out, and it was actually Greg Malpass. And if you look on the ground, there are patches of rocks, there is grass, every room is hashtagged with a unique hashtag. And for some reason, the place is covered in wood. There's wood everywhere. If you have been there, you know what I'm talking about. I didn't ask what the wood was about, but it looked like the place was renovated by beavers. But the one thing that we do know is that Traction is a family. When I was over there at the office, you could tell they have a lot of fun there, but they do care about each other. And they get the work done, all right? Now, this is a company that was voted in the top 10 of top employers to work for in all of Canada. And we can see here an indication why. Now, I don't know if a lot of you people know this, but this is the Traction family. And every person in the family is a member of the Night's Watch. So that's what you see right there. So they protect us from wildlings, right? White walkers and redundant data analysis. So that's what they're doing right there. Yeah, Jon Snow, you know nothing about cloud technology. And neither do most of you people here. Here we go, more time to play. Now, every once in a while, the company goes on wakeboarding trips. In the morning, they go wakeboarding together. And we actually have a very special announcement today. This is for real. Somebody has won the wakeboarding contest, a Traction On Demand employee. And we're going to announce the winner right now. And the winner actually gets a nice trip with Greg Malpass on his custom boat. And they're going to go wakeboarding together. And the winner, and hopefully she's here, Aaliyah. Aaliyah Siddiq. Yeah, there she is right there. Round of applause. Yep. So you won wakeboarding day. So coming up, you're going to spend the day, a nice summer day, with Greg Malpass on his boat. Kind of sounds like a trap to me, but oh, okay, that's whatever. To each his own. Now, of course, Traction is about building community as well, and what they're doing in this slide here is they actually raised $7,000 for the Heart and Stroke Foundation, dressing up in costume, and they were going to do it again this year, but this is for real. They actually didn't because somebody in the area got shot, and then they all got scared, and they decided not to do it. So it teaches us a valuable lesson, right? Karma. When you want to help people, someone's going to die. So there you go. And get her done, this is one of the slogans, one of the mottos of Traction on Demand, because when I was at the office there, I could tell, you know, these people, everyone works hard, they work as a family, and what they were doing here is they locked themselves in the war room and didn't come out until the project was done. And of course, over here, who's this? People that work. Maurice, yes. Maurice is the star of Beer O'Clock. And every Friday at 4 o'clock, Tractioners gather, and they celebrate Beer O'Clock. I don't think I have to explain what that is. But Maurice is actually, did you guys know that Maurice actually came from Craigslist? You guys know that? Yeah, they found Maurice on Craigslist. Now, I am not too proud to say that I have done a little bit of dating through Craigslist, right? I've been in the personal section, and I can tell you right now, this is a lot better than what I found on Craigslist. So there you go, right there. Open that bar. Now, Traction, not on contraception. If you work at the company, you will know the family, they love each other. I would venture to say perhaps they love each other too much because this place is loaded with kids. But a lot of what Traction does, of course, they are future forward thinkers, and what they do is actually for the kids and the next generation. And that brings us to Traction for Good. Now, today, in lieu of swag, every person in this audience, Traction for Good, they're going to donate $10 to charity. So, and there's also going to be stations there where you can buy certain merchandise and items. And every item sold there, all of those proceeds go to charity as well. And that's all part of Traction for Good. How about a round of applause for that? There's going to be a lot of... There is going to be a lot of money raised for good causes today. And why, let's see, release the hounds. Now, this is an example of one of the innovative ways that Traction works with companies. Now, release the hounds is actually a company that does dog sitting and dog walking. Now, on the surface, you would not think that they would have anything to do with data analysis or development of apps or gamification, but that's exactly what Traction On Demand has done for release the hounds. Through working with Traction On Demand, they've been able to really connect with customers more and show through keeping records and communicating with customers how expressing love for the animals. And it's really interesting if you want to check out their website. Now this dog over here, he is not only the president of Release the Hounds, he is also a client. Hair club for men. Okay, let's move on. And over here, TractionForce 2013. How many of you folks were actually at the first TractionForce, by a round of applause? Okay, I see some of you raising your hands there, but okay, that's cool. Now, this is also symbolic of the way Traction has grown. Now, the first TractionForce, a little bit smaller affair, a little bit more low-key, but right away, it blew up. The next year, 2014, was huge, and of course, this one right here in the Commodore Ballroom, and we have more people than ever. How about give yourselves a round of applause for attending here today. And of course, this brings us to TractionForce 2015. So these are a lot of the keywords that we'll be talking about today, and really the general theme is that no matter if you're a small business or a large business, we are all, in a way, a part of the technology business. Data analysis, platforms such as Salesforce, it really is about how we can bend technology to better service what we're trying to do. Not just for now, but in the future as well. So you'll be hearing a lot of these keywords with industry speakers talked about up here. But at the core of it, why we are here as well, it's all about the people. So you will be seeing industry speakers up here. We'll be having a conversational panel. and you'll be in the audience, but this whole event is designed to have a conversation. So there'll be plenty of opportunities for you guys to engage with each other as well. We'll be having roundtable discussions. So we want to hear what you have to say, and there's a lot of people that want to hear what you have to say as well. So we're really glad to have you here. It's all about connection and community. And speaking of technology, I know you guys have smartphones. If at any point you want to tweet out anything during the show, these are the hashtags here, and feel free to use those. And today's agenda, in a few short moments, I will be introducing your keynote speaker. And then we'll have a little bit of a break after several of our sponsors come out here and speak with Greg as well. There will be a customer panel, and then lunch, 12 o'clock, that's when the open bar will happen. Afterwards, there will be roundtable sessions. Now, we're still working on getting some more roundtables in place. So during the break, you can actually check over there to see if you can register for further roundtable discussions coming up. And of course, at 3 o'clock, all good things must come to an end. But this is how today is going to begin. I'm about to introduce the CEO and founder of Traction On Demand. And you know, this is kind of weird. It feels like I'm about to introduce Iron Man, right? Because you know how, like, in the movies, Iron Man, he'll throw a party and everyone comes, of course, because he's Iron Man, right? So it feels like I'm about to introduce Tony Stark. But you know him and you love him. He's the CEO and founder. Please welcome everyone, Greg Malpass.
Thank you, Jeff. Really appreciate the low-pressure introduction. So today's discussion is going to be a little bit different than the more prescribed slide-driven in the long term. And in thinking about what I wanted to talk to you about at TractionForce 2015, I wanted to share the transformation that we've gone through as a business. Because one thing that we're really starting to acknowledge and recognize is we invoke massive amounts of change for the organizations that we work with. And it's all around, you know, what's happening from a technology perspective. So I wanted to share a little bit of what I've learned. And we're going to go through a little bit of a journey, so endure this with me. So I'm going to start with the most important thing. We'll work our way through people, and then we'll find our way back into technology. So the last year has been incredible from a traction perspective. And I'm going to point and shoot, hopefully. And the most important thing is really what's happened from a community perspective. The interactions that we had with the people at Traction, all the Tractionites that chose to join us, the incredible amount of effort that they put into to helping build this organization. It's, first of all, I have a heartfelt thank you to all of you for putting your hearts into this organization. The next group would, of course, be the partners and the customers. And I certainly appreciate the risk that all of you have taken and giving us the opportunity to serve you. And boy, from a serving perspective, look what we've accomplished. We've made 280 new friends in the last 12 months. We completed 1,200 projects and conducted over 1,000 interviews of people that chose or were interested in joining Traction. As, if not more important, we've also had the opportunity to make an impact in our community by executing on 31 implementations of cloud technology for nonprofits and allocating over $250,000, both in in-kind gifts as well as in free services to nonprofits. And I just wanted to take a quick moment, and Michelle is quietly in the audience somewhere, and for those of you who know, Michelle is my wife and she is actually responsible for Traction for Good. But for those of you who are in the nonprofit category and you're making a decision to implement or to invest in technology, it's a brave move because you're constantly under scrutiny in terms of, well, you know, we got to allocate our energy and effort to make good, to make a difference in our communities and to execute our core function. But without the ability to scale, you'll hit a wall. And it certainly takes not just bravery, but some real forward-thinking insight. So I just wanted to take a moment to really sequester a round of applause for the nonprofits that are also in this audience today. I won't spend a ton of time here, but Jeff also was kind enough to take some key points off my presentation. But we've Traction used to be this kind of quietly working behind the scenes organization, and we were starting to break out a little bit. And there's some pretty incredible acknowledgement. But one thing, for those of you who are building organizations in this province, the second one is actually, it's not a point of pride, it's actually a point of, it's an ask. We're the 53rd largest technology company in the province of British Columbia. 5 years ago, we officially hung our shingle. It was 10 years ago that I started the company, but 5 years ago, Mike Levine chose to put on some slippers and join me in that townhouse. And there is so much potential. And what's interesting is all of you, no matter what industry you're operating in, you're all becoming technology companies. So I'm excited for us to slide down the ranks and for the organizations that are in this room to really take the deserving role they have in becoming technology companies. So let's talk a little bit about where we came from, where we're going, and I want to share some learning along the way. And the learning comes not just from Traction, but all the change that we're invoking within within the organizations that are choosing to work with us. The first thing I want to talk about is growth. Our journey from one to what we are today, it's 140 people, has been incredible. And it's had so many turns and so many challenges. And I would say this year, I was forewarned early by some people who've been through it many times. They said, 100's going to take you by the knees and pull you down and force you to change everything. And I took, of course, as I would normally do, I ignored all advice, and we continued down our path. But one thing that really came as a point of learning for us around change was people bring change, people need change, but people fear change. So how do you handle this juxtaposition? If I don't change, people will get bored, they'll leave. If we do change, we're going to create fear and uncertainty. And really, the key with that was understanding how to smoothly bring change into organization. And so we can talk about the models of hiring, the patterns of bringing people into an organization, but this should affect everything. Every time you're implementing a piece of technology, every time you're implementing some sort of functional change within people's functional roles, it's get there early. Start with the people. Smoothly balance all of your transitions. Don't go through bursts, right? Which is difficult, right? Because a lot of it is opportunistic. How do you balance the hires? So as we've scaled it from a Traction perspective, how do we make sure we hire at both ends of the scale? People who have a ton of experience, people that may be just getting started, and really build the mentorship through that cycle. Hiring round robin, or building your organization and your scale through a round robin manner, which is basically with every person and every piece that you plug in, you're going to create a load somewhere else in your organization. Understand the throughput, and you can start actually getting strategic about it. And the last thing is, and this is one that's been really interesting for us, because we used to talk a school of hard knocks. We talk about the tunnel, which is a journey that all new Tractionites would go through. It would be 6 to 9 months, and then things would just click at the end of it. And it just happened, because we had culture and all these things driving forward. We're fundamentally changing our outlook on that and saying, well, how can we actually be much more proactive and invest in the onboarding to lessen the pain through that transition? But we certainly don't want people to be spoon-fed, because innovation and disruptive thinking comes from the journey that's going to be individual to that person. The other thing I learned through this scale is in times of incredible pressure, you may forget some of the cores that allow you to become what you are. And so we always talk about hiring first on cultural fit, on intelligence, and then on skill. And over the course of the last year, we got tons of pressure to grow, huge amount of projects, super complicated, stuff we've never seen before. And maybe we lost our way a little bit. And it was one of those things where you could almost see the business could choose a path. And it's not that one would be more successful than the other, but then the real question is which one do we all want to be part of? Because success can be defined in many terms. And so through our cycle, I'm very proud to say through some very difficult times and adjustments in the business, we have burst through that 100 mark, and we've actually restored back to our original thinking. The other area of change, so that's people and growth and kind of what's happening from an organizational perspective. But what about technology? And Salesforce has made our lives incredibly, Let's start with the word interesting. So here we have a company called Salesforce, right? So when I first started Traction, it was actually Traction Sales and Marketing because there's this disparity between the sales and marketing organizations. And I couldn't get a domain other than Traction SM, which I later find out wasn't the best domain. So then we Traction On Demand. Andrew Buckley, thank you for continually calling that out. But what have we learned around Salesforce? And hopefully there's some nodding heads on this, because we've lived a lot of journeys with a lot of organizations, thousands of implementations of cloud technology, of course, many, if not all, almost 99%, pinning around Salesforce as a platform. And the first thing, and this is a tough one, is anything is possible. Truly, anything is possible with this platform. And why is it not called force.com? I love the idea of it, the company being called force.com. I know, Dave, you know, Leo want to do it, Salesforce is fine. But it's like a wave. And so the one thing is you're looking at all this technology, you're looking at what's possible, anything's possible, there's a sweet spot in a wave. For any of you who have surfed, watched surfing, enjoy watching surfing, I enjoy watching more than doing, so I'm not that great at it. But I'm practicing. The key with the wave is sticking in that sweet spot, not getting too far ahead of what the technology is capable of doing, but not falling too far behind because you may never catch that wave again. And there certainly have been some examples, especially in the areas of portals over the last three years where customers started getting too far ahead of the wave. And what happened is with SaaS, the technology platforms evolve so quickly. You have to keep an eye on these organizations and what's happening in order to make sure that you can ride that sweet spot. And you can also invoke change. Every one of us vote every month as to whether or not we choose to work with Salesforce. Your dollars are votes. And what's important is that we don't behave passively, but we actively drive their roadmap. And that's being participative in events like this, participative through your partners, and also vocal to Salesforce, because they need to hear this. And they've listened. The other really important consideration around Salesforce, we talk about change, we talk about the possibility and the technology. You have two points of true failure. One is data. You can move into a brand new system, it can carry out all the business process you could ever imagine, but if the information is incorrect or it's consistent with the system that you're migrating people from, it's the same piece of garbage, period. The other consideration is around people. And this is a people's motivation to use a system, to see the value in investing that time. I saw a statistic, actually Branson, I think, was talking about this the other day. He was talking about how his belief is technology will create more jobs. It's not going to eliminate jobs. It's shifting our focus. It's allowing us to be more specialized. But change management is such a massive consideration there. And it means, organizationally, you need to test the rigor. How much can your people absorb before they hit their absolute limits? It's like the chicken and the egg. Don't even try to hypothesize on which one should come first. Just assume they both do. The other thing that's interesting is when we talk about Salesforce, we used to talk about CRM. This is Gartner's Magic Quadrant, released a few weeks ago. And you probably can't see it, but what the little blue dot to the top right corner, which Gartner refers to as the Magic Quadrant, is Salesforce.com. Down below are some companies that we've probably all heard about a couple times, Microsoft and Google. And what's interesting about that, if you look at those three, this is platform as a service. This isn't CRM. This is acknowledgement from Gartner that Salesforce has the most robust and complete on-demand platform to carry out business process on the planet. And it also indicates, by the gaps between those little blue dots, that it's a significant margin. So what does this all lead to? I'll tell you what it leads to. Crappy dinner conversations. What do you do? It used to be, we connect sales and marketing teams together. But now, it's, just a second. Have you heard of the cloud? Have you heard of cloud technology? Have you, so when we talk about cloud technology, what are your feelings around customer relationship management? What kind of device? Are you on Android or are you on iOS? The qualifications that I have to carry out to explain to people what I do now is just become unbelievably frustrating to the point now where I'm like, people have needs, and we just satisfy them with technology. Which is seriously the case. The next what change is tribal. And through our transition as an organization, so we were tribal. Small group of people, very tightly, very cohesive. But then as you grow beyond that magical 100 mark, how do you keep connections with individuals? I got 2 minutes. Shoot. Well, we're going over time. Don't worry, it's not that long. I can rip through these pretty quick. The biggest thing with tribal is organizations are made up of people. Right? You have customers, of course. We are a team-first organization. So people plus values equals company. Another really important thing to consider is we talk about balance, and as you're invoking all this change within the companies that you're working with, within your team members, what's their motive and how are they finding not work-life balance, but work-life harmony? If they're highly motivated to go through the change, they're gonna find a way to make that work and fit. And so it's no longer a measure of how many hours I invest, but it's a measure of how engaged and what the value of that time spent is. Am I building equity in myself and in my peers? Other considerations around change, how are you measuring? We've all heard measuring, how measurement basically changes everything, changes how people behave. My cautionary tale is a quick one. Traction implemented a project management system over the course of the last year. We knew exactly what we wanted to use it for, how we want to measure things. We explained that to the team, but the system had some consequential effects. It had this thing called utilization. Nothing that we wanted to actually really pay attention to. We didn't want to measure our business on it. We just wanted a way to keep track of who was working on which projects. And what would happen is we'd shift the work out the week, next week, next week, next week. Well, the people that log in and work in the system would see that they're 300 to 400% overutilized every week for the next week, even though they would have balance in the week that they had. Unintentional measure, massive issue around stress. Change 5 is geography. How do you grow and scale? How do you use technology to go through this? It's funny because there's tools like the double robots. I don't know if any of you guys have seen these on Modern Family. We got them before Modern Family, to be clear. So they're like iPads on sticks. You can drive them around. Anyone can log in. You can talk to people. Unbelievable use case for technology because physical presence in communications versus static screen, it's shocking. It's a little weird at first, talking to an iPad stick that moves around, but you can actually see where these people are looking. As we've scaled through Montreal, we're expanding into Denver, we have LA individuals, and throughout Canada, and there'll be a lot more expansion over the course of the next couple of years. We're experimenting continuously with technology to see what fits the people and the culture. The last change I want to talk about is everything. And this is the change that affects everyone in this room. And I'm really excited because I'm about a minute away from bringing our first speaker and discussion on this topic, is really we're all becoming technology companies, as is Traction. Traction was a professional services firm, but we've launched 2 products in the last year. We have 26,000 users on the platforms that we are implementing. We're spinning off 2 other divisions and 2 other organizations right now. We are going through massive learning because we're not designed to be a software company. And as you look at this, as you're looking at your organization, as you're looking at your customers and how you're going to be most successfully deliver on the promise, the brand promises you're making, one of the questions is how are you embracing not just technology, but how are you embracing the change within your people to make sure your company can not just become relevant, but dominate as you go forward. So along those lines, let's bring up Jeff Booth from BuildDirect. Jeff, come on up. Let's have a chat about change in technology. Oh, you are. All right. Sorry for the embarrassing photo.
Thank you.
So, Jeff, maybe we can just start. You can give us a sense of what does BuildDirect do and what's the journey that you took to get there?
That dinner conversation that you said.
Yes.
This is going back 15 years ago, I was a builder at the time and realized that in this channel, it's one of the worst offenders to customers in the world. And people just put up with it. The control is in the channel, and as an end buyer, you experience this. You pretty well, if you're doing a renovation or a new build, you experience this predictable pattern. I get excited for what the future is gonna look like. Anxious, who can I trust to navigate me to that future? disillusionment. Every friend told me it would cost double or triple and be a total hell, and it is. And then acknowledge, and then just acceptance. Oh, that's just the way the building industry works, and move on. And I was a builder, and I was putting people through this. And I decided not doing this anymore. We're going to create a new way to solve this this pain. So we started to create a business that that would enable empower two people, one on the manufacturer side and one on the buyer side, to meet in the middle. And
so you're a builder.
Yep.
Customers are highly agitated. You're doing your best to kind of make things work and kind of bridge the gap between those two things. I hear a ton of unpredictability in terms of how the process goes. And actually, you know what? We're in the final lengths of building, so I can. It's the most trying thing you could ever do in a relationship. And adding a small child and a birth along the way does not make that easier. So you chose to go into an industry, but is BuildDirect a technology company, or are you on like a retail? Like what? How do you even categorize yourself?
So you just said that. I think all companies are technology companies, and they all will be. The world's moving so fast if I back up to there, we started with technology is moving so fast that it allows you to do different things to connect the dots differently. So we had to build everything new. We had to build an entire ecosystem up from the ground up, because you had two choices. If the existing ecosystem that takes manufacturing product from one side of the ocean or a country, five steps deep into a retail store, that then says a customer needs to drive to that store to pick it up to drive it home on heavyweight goods, would you ever reinvent that? Does it make sense to reinvent all that mess to be able to get there? And it doesn't. It's just, if you drop somebody from space and said, Would you build this again to distribute goods? You'd never build it again with technology coming. You would build a different way. And so we knew that if the pain is caused by all of those steps, if we just build an e-commerce company onto those existing steps, we're gonna just magnify the pain. The pain will happen faster. So we would do nothing to actually solve the real pain. And the real pain is at both ends of the manufacturers in pain because the pipes are too small. There's excess capacity in the world that they can't find real demand, and the buyers in pain from the same thing. So from the ground up, we built a new system.
So you're fundamentally disrupting a category.
Yeah.
Right. It's fair to say you're basically turning upside down.
Fair to say.
We talk about change management and just change in general. You actually have probably arguably three constituents. You have your internal stakeholders, like your internal team. You have the entire, let's call it your sourcing suppliers. Right, all the inputs into your engine, and then you have the consumer, and all three need to change. Where do you even begin with that journey?
We started with a blank page. I think one of the things that for us change was a constant. The world's moving so fast today that as an entrepreneur, you actually everybody's going this way. You see the opportunity to go the other way. And that's taken us, actually, is interested in your talk. Some of the plateaus that you hit in the business require the business to completely change again. So the evidence, and I look at it as this way, as far to tie into something you said. The system that you develop, and that system includes your people, processes, technology, partners, everything else. If you just listen to the audience, if you're growing really fast and it's working, if you listen to the market, it's telling you what's wrong.
Okay.
And really simply, and what ends up happening is you grow really quickly, and you hit a plateau, and something's wrong. Hmm. And that and your whole system at that stage needs to be reinvented. And it might be technology, might be people, might be process. It's probably all of it.
So a lot of it, it sounds like you're... There's a lot of consideration also around just perspective, right?
Yeah.
So I guess as you grow as an organization, your lens, your lens narrows because you get more focused on what you can do, right? You're making fixed decisions in the business, on the customers, on the supply chain, and narrowing your focus. And how do you remain open-minded and almost, like, do you have an opinion around the laser focused versus the listening? Like, where do those things, how do you become a customer-centric organization when you have all this fixed capital and all these assets driving towards a goal?
If you get married to your fixed asset, I'll give you an example. The retail stores are married to their fixed asset. And the retail store has to work. So think about what supports the retail store, the distribution that supports that, and the infrastructure and logistics that support that, and everything else. And then they get married to the people that choose the product for the customers being right. And that whole infrastructure, because of a fixed asset, like a retail store, builds up to ingrain that frame of reference. It's really difficult to change a frame of reference from somebody. What I've learned is, I read 50 books a year, have for 20 years. I am at very many conferences, speaking on panels and speaking at some of the top disruption events in the world, and I can't keep up to how fast the market's moving. It's impossible. And if that is a true fact, which is a true fact, I cannot keep up, then we have to invert the pyramid. And my team needs to move faster. And to enable that, we have to let the market tell us faster. We're really clear on that. I'm not saying there's not changes, and it's exciting, painful, all at the same time. You know, your organization is constantly evolving at that pace, but if you're not getting the result that you expect to get, then the market's telling you what's wrong.
So what that leads me to think, though. So when you originally launched BuildDirect, you built all your own technology, right? From the ground up.
From the ground up.
So now things are moving faster and faster.
By the way, just to tie that, being early and being wrong looks exactly the same. Exactly the same. You look like an insane person for a long time, and then everybody says you're a visionary, but you know you're still a little bit insane.
Okay. So with the notion of continuous insanity, which then apparently is the goal, I guess, you're a technology company, but you use technologies that exist already. So what we thought to be totally holy, right, like our IP, our magic algorithm, all exists in our own proprietary systems, but you're here with a company that implements existing technologies. So where does that sit in the whole paradigm? Why would you even choose to use one or the other?
What is core? What is commoditized? What can you move up the curve? And you guys have been really helpful in some of the stuff that we've implemented. The integration layer is really important. And I think what you consider core and what you outsource and bring in additional talent to help you move faster is a critical differentiation now. And if I go backwards, some of the mistakes we made, some of the plateaus we hit, is because because at the time where we built the original software and technology, there was no ability to outsource that. We had to insource it. So the company gets married to all of its existing tools, and we're smarter than the world and everything else. And that has to change because the world is moving so fast. And you have to integrate best of breed into a platform, and also keep what is core to you, what knowledge, IP, and everything else. Invest in that as your core.
So my last question on this is, okay, so what you're saying is basically don't be married to anything you do. To a certain extent, right?
Different. Challenge your assumptions. Look for the opposing view. When somebody tells you something that doesn't sound right, instead of, that person's insane, challenge your assumptions. Look through that person's viewpoint and say, just a second, there might be something here. So look at people that have done it before in your case, so you guys would see a pattern from a whole bunch of people that you would implement products. We look at that view and we say, is that a relevant view to challenge our own assumptions? And we do that all the time.
And we have a lot of people here, you know, in all kinds of roles and functions. People who lead organizations in this audience. We have a ton of people that are actually working within the systems that can drive incredible change within those organizations. As a CEO, what advice would you provide to these folks who are trying to invoke change and open people's minds to that possibility?
Data speaks volumes. So we talked a little bit before this, but what is the right data signal? So if you have a data signal, I use an example often. Sony, BMG, Universal. On one side you had millions of artists, one side you had millions of wannabe stars, on the other side you had tens of millions, hundreds of millions of people who wanted to find those artists. And Sony, BMG, Universal thought they were better at choosing artists than anyone. And the system just, the data reinforced the loop. So they, because they were choosing, and we listened to the music that they chose, and they couldn't innovate to the other music because it was too expensive, we listened to narrow choice of music 20 years ago. And iTunes blew it up. And they connected a different signal that the artist was in control and the customer was in control. And with that signal, you took a platform that took all of music overnight. And it's so if you're listening, so it's so important to listen, the data speaks to CEO, I'm looking for why, I'm looking for what evidence do you have of this, so great data sets you free, but you also need to be careful that you're not reinforcing a data signal that is biased, naturally biased.
Fascinating. Jeff, thank you.
Thank
so
you
so much
thank
for
much.
For spending
thanks
some
for
time
your help.
Yeah. Gosh, no worries. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you very much. I could spend an hour. Actually, I could spend days talking to Jeff about the just the thinking behind BuildDirect. And what's incredible, as someone who's actually gone through the customer experience, is just the fact that I could bypass virtually everything. And the opposition, so we're going through this house build process, and our builder was absolutely against the use of BuildDirect because it was so disruptive. And they wanted control of the value chain. But the truth is, I can get the same products that my builder would get faster through an online platform. And I've changed their behavior as a result of it. Next up is David Borrelli. David is a great friend of Traction. Dave, come on up. He's the Area Vice President, Salesforce.com.
Thanks, Dave. How are you?
Great.
So thanks for digging up that photo of me.
That's my
best Ricky Bobby. I think it was a Groupon gift for my wife at some point.
Thank God for Facebook. So Dave, you are responsible for Salesforce.com's commercial group. Commercial sales organization. And just to give people some context on that, that represents basically from a quantity and a total employee load of organizations in Canada, probably about, 95% of organizations within
probably a little bit less than that, but typically any company under 2,500 employees, which makes up a large portion of the Canadian economy.
Yeah, we could probably count those on our two hands in BC. So you see a lot of activity coming through Salesforce. You see a lot of customers who are considering the platform, or prospects, let's say. You see a lot of customers who are continually voting as to whether or not they want to continue to use your platform. And you probably see also a lot of customers that are trying to push the boundary and figure out kind of where the stress points are, how far they can push it. What patterns, why are people even considering Salesforce.com? What kind of commonalities are you seeing kind of across your view?
Yeah, I mean, I think it starts with the acceptance of cloud, number one, right? When I started with Salesforce 8 years ago, the conversations were much, much different. We were trying to justify it and say things like, hey, you know, I'm sure a few hundred years ago, people were worried about and concerned about giving their money to a big company to put it behind a big silver box. And now I think people would argue that you're crazy if you kept it under your mattress. And I think the same is true with data in the cloud. So it's becoming much more accepted in our world. But I think what I see with companies coming in, and again, in my segment, I typically see companies that are either high growth or focused more on profitability. And so for the high growth companies, or like what we like to say is that they're temporarily small businesses, you know, they're really looking to technology to differentiate, right? Similar to what we heard with Jeff. You know, speed is sort of the new currency of business. There was a time when the currency of business was really just money. Big players would buy market share, they'd have big advertising budgets, they'd buy up smaller competitors and eat the market. And now we're seeing companies like BuildDirect or like Uber who are disrupting industries, right? Uber is a company that that is becoming the biggest taxi company in the world. They don't own a single car. Or Airbnb is becoming the biggest hotel company in the world, and they don't own a single property. So high-tech companies are really looking to technology to differentiate. The other side of it is they really want to reduce their silos to make sure that when they do become, you know, a company with hundreds or thousands of employees, they don't have a mess of an architecture in the back end. We're dealing with a manufacturing company in Ontario right now that has gone through some pretty tremendous growth in the last 10, 15 years, some organic and some by acquisition. And now that they have the resources to invest in technology, they just have so many silos because during that growth, every time they hit a pain point, they put in a point solution. Pain point, point solution. And really what they're looking for now is a platform, but the change management effort is huge for them. So yeah. It's worrisome. I know on the companies that are more focused on profitability, I think what we're seeing is really a push towards more efficiency and driving costs lower. A couple years ago, I dealt with a professional services company, not a big one, about 80, 90 employees, and their CEO, because resource allocation is everything to them, as you know, he was hell-bent on managing vacation time off himself, and he did that through spreadsheets, and A, it took a ton of time out of his day, and B, it was prone to errors. So what he did was we basically built an app in Salesforce to manage it, and the best part was he'd already deployed the licenses. They were sunk costs, and now he didn't have to spend any time on it, and the margin for error went way down.
So there's one thing that you were talking about that just it triggered, I think, an item that is often, a word that is often said frequently, but people never really drill into it, which is this whole concept of fail fast. Right? It's the whole oxymoron of, oh, no one wants to fail in business. We can't afford a single failure. Our staff have zero tolerance of failure. But what we're seeing now is more and more people say, no, it's fail fast. Can you kind of talk a little bit about that in terms of what you're seeing? That is obviously not everything is successful in every endeavor, yeah. But how do you turn fail fast into succeed?
I think it's simple. It gets down to the technology that you choose, because when you choose a platform that that has a lot of agility, it gives you that ability to fail fast, pivot, and move on. And that's really where I think we see a lot of our customers succeed with the platform. They're always testing. And so if something doesn't work, they can evolve quickly with the business and move. And that's, again, gets back to speed is the new currency of business.
And then the other interesting, so Jeff was talking about almost from a customer perspective, customers, you want to give them the most open vote to indicate what they want. And a vote can be a conscious thing or an unconscious thing. From a Salesforce perspective, what advice would you have to organizations looking to implement these solutions? How do you engage your constituents? How do you engage your customers and your employee stakeholders to figure out what you can do and how to right-size that? Any wisdom there?
The most important thing, if you're considering any type of technology deployment, is getting alignment through and through the organization. I always tell customers that the commitment of your users for whatever technology you're choosing is going to mimic that of your executive and your management team. And so it's really about having alignment throughout the organization, top to bottom. And I think the best practice is really educating and getting everybody to buy into a top-end goal, right? You don't ever want to make technology seem like it's just Big Brother out to get you. I think the most successful organizations are ones that paint a vision, right? Here's where the company's going. We want to go public. We want to gain market share. Here's the benefit for everyone in this company if we achieve those goals. Here are the strategies we need to put in place, and here are the solutions and the tactics we're going to need to use to get there and drive that kind of buy-in. And I think the important thing is don't just walk away from the project the second you buy it and expect that people are just going to adopt. We had a Toronto World Tour, a Salesforce event in Toronto a couple weeks ago, and one of our customers out there, Trailer Wizards, which is they lease truck trailers, they deployed about a year ago, and now they're into phase two because they're starting to see the value. And the CEO rented two coach buses and brought 50 people to the event. He put them all in sessions that were relevant to them, and then held an all hands afterwards to get real time feedback. I mean, you know, his involvement level doesn't have to remain like that, but during this critical phase, that's what drives adoption, and I've never seen anything like it.
So that's basically getting engagement right through the organization and making sure everyone eats the dog food.
Absolutely.
Often when you have someone from Salesforce on a stage, we talk a lot about Salesforce and their customers, and this is totally unscripted, so I do apologize if I create some exposure. When I first started working with Salesforce.com, it was a company of 400 people, and that was a little over a decade ago. When you joined 8 years ago, you were saying it was a little over 1,000.
Yep.
How does Salesforce, and obviously you're using Salesforce.com as a platform to run your entire business, and today Salesforce has,
I think, about 16 or 17,000 employees.
And over $6 billion in revenue that
yep.
people are continually voting as to whether or not they want to continue with. How is Salesforce managing the technology change internally? Like, what stuff are you guys doing that is being driving the success of the business? I think it's inarguable success. What are your favorite things that Salesforce does to drive and support
yeah.
the process of change?
I think the most important point there is that no company in the world is perfect. I often read about our own company, and we're always made out to be, you know, the big giant, the company that grew seamlessly, and it's never painless. If you go into any type of technology project and expect it to be smooth and seamless, you don't have good expectations. You can mitigate all that risk. But, you know, I think it gets back to painting the vision, helping everybody understand why we're making the changes we're making. We just recently went through a big CPQ change, which wasn't easy. And, you know, there's still some pain points amongst all the users, but everyone's committed to it because we knew that once we get to the point where we need to be, it's going to make everyone's lives better. And I think communication from the top is probably the most important thing.
Awesome. Dave, I just want to say thank you so much for flying out here, meeting us here, and also just for being so open to such a candid, kind of open conversation around the technology, customers, what things are happening. So thank you sincerely
thank you.
For joining
it.
Us.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
All right.
So we've talked about organizations who are fundamentally changing their value chain. We've talked to Dave, and we talked about Salesforce, an organization that's providing the platforms and the systems and having this kind of broad macro view and how companies are evolving and leveraging their platforms. But what about the voice of the customer? What about how are customers making kind of the incremental votes in terms of where the organization is going, what their preferences are? How do you leave that as open as possible so you can continue to be responsive, not just reactive? Neil Jones, come on up. Neil is a long-term friend of Traction. We've been working with Clicktools for 9 years. First implementation of Salesforce, which was with a company called Borrelli. So Neil, please grab a seat. Neil, let's talk a little bit about customers. So what are you seeing from a pattern perspective? How are companies keeping in touch with the people that are voting as to whether or not they like them?
Well, a really good question, Greg, and it's one that's been somewhat of a challenge. So I think as technology evolves and as we're talking about this, we're talking about disruptions of business, voice of the customer is a huge part of that, and what we're seeing is companies are getting back to wanting to know what the customer thinks and what the customer says matters. And so from our perspective, as you know, Clicktools was founded back in 2001, so about the time you were really getting started. We were doing the same thing. The technology itself was about driving customer feedback into CRM. And so we made a decision, as you did, to build on the Salesforce.com platform. And really, all we've seen from that decision forward is growth of customer feedback. Centralizing customer feedback in a solution like CRM where so many sales and marketing and service organizations spend their time. So being able to see a single view of the customer whether you're in sales, whether you're in marketing, whether you're in service, if I'm an account executive at an organization and I'm going out to meet with my client and I see that we've had some bad service engagements because of the feedback that's driven into CRM, it's going to be important for me to know there might be a problem, and I don't want to get blindsided walking into that meeting.
So one of the other things is, so we hear a lot about how customers are evaluating, or how organizations are evaluating customer feedback, and of course Net Promoter is probably the most common lip service feedback mechanism. It's interesting to me in that when should we be asking our customers how they feel about us?
Well, it's all the time and as much as you can. However, you don't want to over survey, or there's a point of a degradation, I think, where you might be asking too much. It's really more about what points along the customer journey should I be asking specific questions, and the specific questions are tied to the interaction. So it might be something transactional. It might be after a case gets closed or after an opportunity is closed, or it might be something relational where each year we want to know how did we do this past year, or twice a year, how often. Or we might want to query our customers and say, how are we doing for you?
And so you gather these votes, right? So we ask our customers questions around how they feel about us at certain points of time, case closed, whatever elements. What kind of response are you typically seeing, or what would you recommend organizations consider in terms of the feedback loop? So, hey, how do you feel about us? One could be, I feel amazing. You guys are absolutely incredible. We want to work more with you. Of course, there's the other polar, which is hopefully it balanced within some reasonable respect. Any best practices you're seeing in terms of how companies are actually taking that data and becoming accountable? Like, if you're asking a question, the assumption is you should do something about it and be accountable to it.
Right. Don't ask a question unless you're prepared to act on it. And I think a lot of organizations over the years have been afraid. We want to know what our customers think, but we're afraid to ask. And really, it is about driving action. So, if you're asking the questions and they're specific to an engagement, be prepared to act on those. And I think I was telling Mike earlier that I used to manage our sales team as well, and we had closed one opportunity. So every time an opportunity was either closed one or lost, a survey would go out. And I drove certain parameters within that survey. So if any question was below a certain minimum threshold, I was notified immediately. On the phone with that customer or lost prospect within 2 minutes. And the reaction I would get invariably was, wow, I can't believe you actually did something. And that's really what it's about, driving change. So not only don't be afraid to ask the questions, but be prepared to act and be prepared to respond in kind, because for so many customers, they don't think anyone's listening. And I think Mike shared a really good example with me a few minutes ago about an incident he had where he had submitted feedback, and it was months ago. He still hasn't heard back. So whether or not that company did anything, in his mind, it's not good customer service.
Awesome. Neil, one last question. I guess you see a lot of use cases of the Clicktools platform. What is the coolest use case that you've seen in the last, let's frame it at least, the last 12 months of customer feedback? Is there anything that just has just resonated with you?
The Advanced Star one we're going to see, I think, on the video was pretty impressive to me. I don't want to spill the beans on that one, but we do have a customer who does uses Clicktools internally for project management to some degree. So it's driven off of negative feedback, and a survey goes out. They're a company, I can't name them contractually, but they are a company that does pharmaceutical testing for the big pharma companies in the U.S. And their customer, it's a B2B, obviously, so their customer gets surveys from them using Clicktools, and they drive a closed-loop process when they get that feedback. And the way it works is, it used to be run on that closed-loop process was somebody would be notified, and then it went through a 90-day cycle and had five different stages all run off of Word and Excel internally. So they had a process. It was very manual. It was taxing for the users. They basically brought Clicktools in because they were already using us for feedback and realized, wait a minute, because the data writes to custom objects and fields within Salesforce, or standard custom objects and fields as well, we can drive process through Clicktools and in Salesforce, so people never have to leave the application. And that's essentially what they're doing now. I don't have metrics on it, but I know their time spent on that 90-day process, those five stages, it's all automatic, and it's all driven through Salesforce using Clicktools forms.
Awesome. Yeah. Neil, thanks so much for coming out. We're actually going to roll that video and have a chance to kind of learn a little bit about Clicktools, a little more about the platform, but I really sincerely appreciate you coming all the way up. Thank you.
Thank you, appreciate it.
Thank you.
Our old system was built by our registration vendor, and that locked us into using that vendor for every show that we had. Once we closed a show, and then we wanted to open up a new one, ideally we'd like to open up a new registration piece for the next event as soon as the old show closed. Well, we'd have to wait. There was a lag time. So what we wanted to do is we wanted to migrate out of their CRM into our own Salesforce platform, and that's when we engaged Traction On Demand.
Here's an organization that runs the largest trade shows and events really in the world when it comes to fashion, they have motorcycle shows, and they're looking for a system to improve the entire guest experience. And so we had a number of conversations with UBM AdvancedStar and came to terms with the fact that we would use Salesforce.com as the back end to collect the data, but actually as a device or the actual technology that would sit on the devices that people would interact with. It would all be done through Clicktools.
With AdvancedStar, they have a very unique use case in trade show registrations. Because of the process that they go through, they not only need to register their attendees for the events, but they also need to qualify them. So Clicktools is the perfect tool for them because it not only gives them the flexibility to be able to build out specific forms that are tailored to their registration process, but because they also manage 50 plus trade shows per year, they can independently brand each survey or registration form in this case to match that specific trade show. Because they do so many different shows, it ranges in size from very small to as many as 30,000 attendees, and being able to automate that process, it really, really does make a big difference for them, and the flexibility of Clicktools allows for that.
It's really been a great experience. When we look at our business partners and what we're looking for, we're looking for people that are creative, you know, intelligent, and willing to work with us. They're able to have conversations, it's open, it's honest, they're willing to tell us no, so they're always helping us look at what's best long term.
Clicktools, Traction, Salesforce have been key strategic elements within our business line. It's very easy to integrate with Salesforce. It provides all the functionality that we're looking for, and it is robust enough to grow forward with us. We can utilize it in other lines of business that we hadn't even originally envisioned whenever we brought the tool in the first place.
In any circumstance where we're looking to implement a form that would sit on any type of digital device, we're looking to Clicktools. And what that's going to do, it's going to allow us to put value essentially under the control of the organization faster. It's going to speed up our overall implementation and allow us to move to the next project. Because the reality is business is moving so quickly. There's no start-stop. It's just a continuous evolution. And the faster you can get through each sequence, the faster you can pick up the next one, and the faster you can bring value.
Paul Staelin, come on up. Paul is a co-founder of Birst and the chief customer officer.
Thank you.
Paul, thank you so much for coming all the way up to the Great White North.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
So I love how a story is starting to unfold, right? So we start the journey with, of course, just a journey of change and growth. We get into talking to Jeff, and like here's an organization that's basically saying data is the lifeblood of what we do, and it's so important that we don't narrow our focus or put a filter on it. Then we talk to Salesforce, right, for Dave, in terms of, well, we have a platform and infrastructure to collect all this information to allow people to interact with it. Then Neil talks to us about the customer and how they're voting and providing some more insights. There's a lot of data there. So I guess, like, where do you even begin? So as a co-founder of Birst, there was obviously a problem that you were looking to solve. Maybe we can just start there. What were you looking to solve? BI is an old industry. You decided to start a company in one of the, you know, a pretty big category.
Yes, it starting a company takes a healthy mix of optimism, energy, and ignorance. What we were really trying to do, fundamentally, Brad Peters, who was featured on the video, my co-founder, and I were at Siebel Systems and kind of managed and ran different parts of the Siebel Analytics product line. And the core challenge that Siebel Analytics was trying to solve was trying to make the process of taking data, making it analytically ready, and then presenting it to business users faster by basically pre-building using the existing software stack, which is kind of ETL tools, a data warehouse, and then a BI layer on top. We pre-build it, you hook it up. Was the hypothesis. Except everyone customized Siebel, they customized SAP. The process, because we didn't make the process any faster, same process, just we hardwired it for you, didn't go as well as Siebel had hoped. So Brad and I left to kind of change the process and make it a much faster, simpler kind of way to get from data to analytically ready data to end users making decisions. And we've kind of reimagined the entire platform. I love the BuildDirect story, if someone dropped from outer space on the planet, you would never build a supply chain for building materials that looks like this today. We firmly agree that, back in the early 2000s, if someone dropped down from space, they would never build a process that requires, 12 different servers, 3 different vendors, for you to kind of slowly flow the data through to the end user. And we really are about trying to make that fast. Speed kills. Change is, the pace of change has gotten nothing but faster. Every one of us has to be working at a different company next year, not, the name on the business card hopefully is the same. But we all need to change and grow, and faster and faster. Speed is what determines it, and we try to make that process faster to help support that.
So when we think of analytics, dashboards, reports, and the kind of the higher level, the typical, like the truthful response, I ask a question, and then 3 months later, I get my reports, because I had a hypothesis, and then I get a result. But now I'm 3 months invested, and I'm pretty married to that. What are you seeing, what is the kind of the response, you say faster, what is the response time, and how do I even begin to ask questions to the Birst platform to maintain that agility? Like, what advice or what are you seeing?
We're seeing a lot of companies who are kind of struggling with the pace of change and what's required today. The way that we often get engaged, we've got people who have, taken the leap to the cloud, often with Salesforce. By the way, we're a huge Salesforce customer, big Clicktools customer. Well, not big, little. Hopefully, we'll be bigger with them. But really trying to get into a platform where you can much more flexibly and quickly kind of alter, evolve, and change your analytical processes. And there's no point in getting fast at implementing processes if you can't see how you're doing, both in terms of kind of the adoption of the new processes and in terms of their effectiveness. To be able to listen to your business processes and make better decisions on it is going to require data. We humans, as decision-making vehicles, are highly flawed. There's recency bias, selection bias, confirmation bias. We really do much, much better if you've got the data available to you. Having a system that can greatly, radically accelerate the preparation of that data, allow you to monitor that process, to listen to your customers. Your customers are telling you every day how you're doing. There are very few businesses where, it's a couple of deals a year. If you're in any business with any velocity in terms of your pipeline, your orders, your service requests, your customers are talking to you every single day. Having a mechanism in place to kind of readily assimilate that data, process it and present it to people so they can see what's going on is radically empowering. So for us, in most cases, traditional BI projects to go from start to, I have a dashboard is about a year, reports can be many months. In our platform, we are going from source systems to initial reports in 4 to 8 weeks. So it's a dramatically different way. And, the market has been going this way for a long time with disparate tools, creating a unified one and cutting across, as again, using the analogy from the BuildDirect guys, is exactly what we did, trying to make this a much more seamless, integrated thing where you get a lot more power and leverage out of having a cloud platform that does this.
So I think that one of the more important words in that last sentence is cloud. So we're talking about terabytes, or I heard petabytes of data was a reference I heard recently in reference to Birst. what allows you to manage this in the cloud? Like, historically, that's when you have the big shiny silver boxes between the glass walls that you're paying exorbitant amounts of money to maintain. How does Birst manage to actually provide full cloud BI?
Well, we've developed a unique technology platform to do this, right? It really is enabled by the cloud, to have this kind of holistic integrated platform that makes the process of taking data and making it analytically ready much faster, and then presenting it to the end user in a way that they can consume, whether it be mobile or on a browser or however it reports that you can email. It's old school, but people still do it. Being able to do all those things, we've kind of reimagined how you host this too, right? We're fully multi-tenant. We've done a lot of very clever things that our approach uniquely enables. And we do have, we've got about a petabyte in our Birst cloud. We do have an appliance version, so you can run it locally. I think except for Salesforce, almost every cloud company has had that pull to sell a version you can run in-house if you've got whatever security concerns that may or may not be well-founded, but that you have them. So we really have achieved kind of a very, it's a modular multi-tenant design that you can just kind of keep scaling out. It's fundamentally the baseline that we've used to enable it. But it's relatively profound in terms of the reach, the power, the speed that you can be up and running by being able to leverage the cloud.
And so this is, it's complicated, but it could be simple. I guess historically you'd want data scientists involved in, or someone we've heard the term data scientist is pretty much probably the hottest thing to put on your LinkedIn profile. Total side note, data scientist. There's no certification for a data scientist that I know of, so you're probably safe for now. But who should be asking the questions? You know, are you saying everybody? Are you saying there should be a small group? What are you suggesting?
Fundamentally, aim the mic.
That
this
was
way,
a
maybe.
Powerful.
There we
statement.
Go. We're big believers that fundamentally, as the speed of business changes, you really need everyone in your organization who makes decisions to make them better. And being able to take a platform that allows you to kind of disseminate insight broadly in your organization. I mean, I would argue very passionately, for those of you who've met me, the dashboards are the best way to do that. Business users can click, they can drill, they can manipulate filters. It's relatively easy for a business user to consume that. And I would argue if you get people on the front lines and you empower them to make three or four of their decisions they make every day, they can make better with data. And then next sprint, three, 4 weeks later, it's gonna be seven or eight decisions a day. And next sprint is gonna be 10, 11, 12. You can make those people make better decisions, and kind of again, data enables people to get kind of over our hardwired short circuiting that we do for decision making, and really allow you to kind of look at the facts and look at what your customers, your business, your processes are telling you, and make much better fact-based decisions. The data scientists generally play a key role back at headquarters in terms of helping model out the data, making sure that it's represented right, it is analytically ready. The role of the data scientist has historically been kind of the smart person in the corner, whipping through VLOOKUPs on Excel and doing crazy things that you probably don't want to tell your mother about with the data. But giving them kind of a voice and a megaphone that they can then kind of share that analytically ready with the rest of the organization is something that really is empowering and brings scale.
Awesome. So my last question, it's interesting. We look at social media. Right, and you could argue really social has just created another spamming device for marketers, would be kind of the negative side of that, but there certainly is a ton of opportunity. But we're starting to see social come into the organization, and I've heard the term social analytics a few times now, and this seems like it's something that bringing those two, the conversation into the data. Any insights that you can share at this point around this concept around social analytics, where you see things going if we were to look out the next 6 months?
Yeah, well, the interesting thing, at first you've got to be able to kind of capture that sort of data. And people that kind of, in Hadoop, clickstream data is a big one. There's a bunch of places where you can get some of this less structured data that really tell you a lot about what people are really doing, right? The power that most of our customers really find when they first get that data kind of organized is that the real power and the bang for your buck in terms of driving your business and informing it is then blending that with kind of the more structured data that you've got in the enterprise, your orders, right? They clicked here, they clicked here. Did they order? What did they order? How often did they order? Who did this path? Who did that path? Who's talking to who? And really blending kind of social data, which on its own is interesting, but far more empowering when you blend it with what you know, the other signals you're getting from your customers. So you can really see and track who's saying what, who's doing what, and really get some power out of that combined view.
Yeah. Seems like it's pure competitive advantage once you start unlocking the keys there.
It's tremendously empowering. The more you know about your customers, the better you can serve them. And if you find it out first, you're going to beat your competitors there. Speed is the new currency. Absolutely. And I do want to congratulate you guys on a fabulous year. I do also want to congratulate you on not relaunching Traction SM with the tagline, people have needs, we satisfy them.
Yeah, yeah, you know, that's a great point. Thank you so much, Paul. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.